Hello, and welcome to Kaioke Online. We're thankful that you chose to worship with us. If you're near Appling, we invite you to join us in person at 2520 Ray Owens Road. For those outside the area or anyone who's physically unable to attend, we want you to know that you're an important part of Kaioke, and we're grateful for you. To support the ministries of the church, you can utilize any of the methods listed here. We want to thank you for your prayer support as well. As we prepare to enter teaching time with Pastor Steve, let's ready our hearts with worship.
You call me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail. And there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. And rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you keep my eyes above the waves. My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you.
Thankful that you've decided to join us as we prepare to open God's Word. We're going to do things a little bit different this time. Normally, we pick a passage and we exposit it. We go through it. We teach through it verse by verse. Today, it's going to be a little bit of a broader view of study in Scripture. We're still going to anchor our remarks and our thoughts on God's Word, but it's going to be from more of outside any one particular passage, although we are going to try to contain our thoughts for the most part to one book. But I want to start by sharing about two people that I pastored in Central Texas. Their names were Bill and AJ. They were farmers. They were members of AG Baptist Church while for years and year, decades. And I was blessed to be their pastor when they were both up in years. Bill and AJ were husband and wife. Bill was the wife. AJ was the husband. And every fourth Sunday, Susan and I would stay with them. We would eat lunch with them after church, and then we'd stay at their house unless there were visits that needed to be made. We'd stay there. I'd go over notes until our evening service that Sunday. Now, while most people in Central Texas, East Central Texas, West Central Texas, while most people north of Houston generally receive the Dallas Morning News as a paper, and particularly in the little area that our church was in, some people received the Stephenville Empire Tribune as a newspaper. Even Dallas Cowboys Weekly was a popular selection for some of the folks in our little church. But for Bill and AJ, the paper of record was that bastion of truth, the National Enquirer. And I have to tell you, when I first started pastoring, and we would visit with them. Initially, I decided I'm not going to read it. You know, I've never heard anything good about the National Enquirer. I'm just a young guy, still a student at seminary. But then finally, after so long going to their house and just falling in love with the two of them, I gave in and I began to read it. And I can remember one late Sunday afternoon, I was just kind of looking at the headlines of the stories, and AJ walked through the door and caught me looking at it, and he made the statement something like, "I'm sure you're as surprised as I am. I never knew that Martians sometimes have two heads." And I wasn't sure if he was serious, and I looked at him, and as he's about to leave the room, he just gave me a little wink, and it kind of settled my nerves. But one thing about the National Enquirer, if you've ever read it, or you really don't even know to read it, if you've just ever glanced at it while you're in line at the grocery store, you know that it's full of conspiracy theories about all kind of things. things that are not limited to the National Enquirer, but groups and plans and plottings. There's the Illuminati, Skull and Bones, the New World Order, the Trilateral Commission, the Council on Foreign Relations, all these different groups that are planning to take over the world and are really pulling the levers and the strings of every government and everything that ultimately takes place. And though I knew that the National Enquirer, now there was no such thing as the term clickbait back in the 80s, but that's in essence what it was basically they put things on the cover to catch your attention. There was, I slowly kind of seeped in, recognized that there's something very alluring about these stories. There's something somewhat otherworldly. They capture your imagination, even though with one side of your brain, you know this is a joke. This is there's no way this stuff can be true. But there's a part of you that go on some of the closer to reality written stories, you're going, maybe. Well, I eventually decided that it ultimately was not good for my soul to read the National Enquirer, especially when I had to preach the Word of God within a matter of hours. And one reason is that I realized that conspiracy theories have certain effects. And over the years, I've noticed that these effects are not limited to me, but they're pervasive amongst much of our population today. They build suspicion. They promote doubt. Eventually, quite often, fear, as your acceptance of what they're espousing kind of begins to settle in. And if they're not thwarted, in other words, if you don't capture them, they will begin to consume your thought life because you see a conspiracy behind every bush. And you're looking for things to confirm your conspiratorial bias. Now, let's be honest. Conspiracies and conspiracy theories are as old as the Garden of Eden, right? I mean, in essence, when the serpent approaches Eve and tempts her to eat of the tree that she knew she was not to eat of, remember, his line to her was the chief of conspiracy lines. Surely you won't die. God said this, but surely he didn't mean that. So they're with us. They've been with us. They are nothing new. I can recall when I was at seminary, going up to the historical section of the library of books that you couldn't check out, but you could pull them off the shelf once you signed into that section, open them and read them because they were so old. And I can recall reading books that were a couple of hundred years old that espoused conspiracies about how one group was plotting to take over the church or plotting to take over the world. Historically, some conspiracies are really more than theoretical. They're true. And I don't want to sound like every conspiracy that you ever hear about, read about, or has been foisted upon mankind is a joke. Because if you feel like there might be people out to get you, guess what? There might be people out to get you. There might be people that if they could bring it about, they would take over the world. They would control the American government or some other nation's government. But one question today is, for us, that I want us to address is the proper understanding of matters that Scripture calls under the sun events, and how they affect and should affect and should be understood by a follower of Jesus Christ. How do we wrap our hands around things that seem like they're not only out of our control, but maybe in their attempt to control, they are outside the realm of the hand of God? Well, I look at this now. I've been wrestling with this topic, and really one of the reasons is I think it does, for someone inclined to believe that there are events that are affecting all of us that we are all blind to, and there are groups that function, and God has no... Maybe he has knowledge, but he has no ability to control, that most Christians would go, I don't believe that. I don't believe anything is beyond the control of God. But the truth is, a lot of Christians live their lives that way. Not merely about conspiracy. Listen, conspiracy theories can be great big, right? That where we think somebody is affecting a country or the world. But conspiracy theories affect us privately and personally. You know, when at your job, you think somebody is out to supplant you, to take your job away, or if you're up for a promotion, somebody's out to see to it that you don't get the promotion. Those are little C conspiracies, right? And they may be very real. But how do we deal with that? How do we deal with things that seemingly are outside of our control? Well, in 3 months, it's pretty much assured that whoever wins the presidential election, the loser and his or her party will say something like stolen election conspiracy. This was not fair and square. And by the way, it won't be the first time. We saw it 4 years ago, but we've seen it throughout the history of American elections. Some elections really were stolen. Some just conspiracies built up about it. I feel very confident somebody, the losing party, will cry, not fair. Not fair. So how do we, as Christians who follow the God who the Bible says appoints kings and rulers and changes kings and rulers, how do we reconcile being absorbed with the efforts of man while God determines what will happen? Be it globally, be it nationally, or be it personally, privately. How do we live that out? Does God really reign and rule over my life? Does he really reign and rule over the affairs of men? Well, I want to start by reading reading a half a verse. It's found in the book of Esther, chapter 5, and it's the first part of verse 9, and this is what it says. And Haman went out that day joyful and glad of heart. Now let's just stop. If you know nothing about Haman, you know nothing about his background, nothing about his story, and you read this, which perhaps is the case for many, the only thing we can really know about this Haman is that wherever he left, wherever he was leaving, he was a happy camper. Scripture says that he was joyful and his heart was glad. What a great way to live. What a great thing to be. But here's what a more exhaustive look at the book of Esther will tell us, is that while Haman was happy, joyful, glad in this moment, things had transpired. A conspiracy had been afoot that he had prompted and led up to this point in the story of Esther, but that from this point on, his life is about to blow up and everything is going to change. So let's do this. I know that's a long intro. It's an intentional. Let's pray, and then I want to give a little bit of background to what's going on that's made Haman so happy and why it's about to change. So let's pray, and then we'll take a look. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for you and the stability that the God who has created the universe, the God who holds up and sustains all things, the God who sets the stars in the sky and calls them each by name, would care, know, and determine the affairs of men and women. You always have. You always will. So thank you for your word. We pray that you'll open our eyes, that we'll see clearly, and open our ears, that we'll hear from you and only from you. And we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. So let's do a little bit of a look at what's happening in the book of Esther. This is a historical setting, and it is a historical story. This is not make-believe. One of the great things about the Word of God is that so often history, and as Scripture records it, is much more entertaining, exciting, sometimes unbelievable, than Hollywood could ever conceive. So here we go. If you're familiar with what happens to the Jews after the fall of the southern kingdom, Judah, Nebuchadnezzar puts a siege to Jerusalem, and he carries back much of the elite Jewish society, men and women. He takes back to Babylon. Well, it's not very long till not only Nebuchadnezzar dies, but the Babylonians are taken over. They're taken over by the Persians. And this is the story. It opens up in chapter 1, verse 1, by saying, "In the days of Ahasuerus, the Ahasuerus who reigned from India to Ethiopia over 127 provinces. In those days, when King Ahasuerus sat on his royal throne in Susa, the citadel, in the third year of his reign, he gave a feast for all his officials and servants." Now, it's a pretty clear, pretty specific setting for us to know historically. King Ahasuerus is believed to have been the king that bore the Greek name Xerxes. And he was a real king. This was a real empire, a real rule, reign of this particular king. He throws a party. We're not going to read all of this. He throws a party for all of his people that are anybody. He gathers them to this banquet. There's drinking going on. There's festivities going on. All along, his wife, the queen, whose name is Vashti, throws a party, a banquet for the women of these soldiers and nobles. And so you've got two different banquets, the king's banquet, their wives' banquet, thrown by Vashti the queen. Well, eventually, after several days, Ahasuerus says, "Bring me my queen, for she is beautiful, and I want to show her off to all of these men." So the word goes to Queen Vashti, "The king is calling for you to join him at the royal banquet." And Queen Vashti makes a decision that will not only change her life, but will change, pretty much put in play everything that's about to happen in the book of Esther. And here's what I just would draw to your attention is that time after time, people make decisions that affect what's going to happen and what God is going to do. Now, God's not mind isn't changed. He knows exactly what's going to happen. But there's no other way to explain what happens than to say, God has this. So Vashti's decision is, I'm not going. We don't know why. She just decides she's not going. King is angry. His nobles, his officers, they see that how angry he is, and they get angry because this is their reasoning. You know what, king? If the queen is able to embarrass you and to say no to you, our wives will pick up on that, will know that, and they will say no to us. This is horrible. And Ahasuerus realizes that. You can imagine one of these officers going home to his wife and saying, "I want you to come with me when I return to the banquet." And his wife saying something like, "I don't see no crown on your head. And if the queen won't go to the king, why should I go with you?" That's what's driving this. So it is suggested to Ahasuerus, here's what you need to do. You need to basically put word out that Queen Vashti will never see you again, that she will be put in exile, and you will find a new queen. Well, that sounds good. That sounds good to Ahasuerus, and that's what happens. As a result, a few years later, Ahasuerus decides it's time for him to get a new queen. And so there is word is sent out throughout the empire for all the beautiful young maidens to be brought to Susa, where the king rules from. And that's what happens. And amongst all of those beautiful young maidens is a young lady, a young girl, probably, it's most commentators believe, she probably wasn't much older than 17. Was a Jewish girl named Esther. And so Esther is brought to Susa, and there, over the course of a year, she and the other ladies that keep making these cuts are fed properly, are bathed in oils. I mean, they are taken care of, treasured, and Esther is one of them. Well, it just so happens that Esther, who was an orphan after her parents died, was raised up by a man named Mordecai, who's actually her cousin but is considerably older than her. Mordecai loves this young lady with the love of a godly father as a parent. And so, as Esther is being promoted to her day in the court where she's led before the king falls head over heels. He not only has a deep physical attraction to Esther, but over the course of time, he begins to emotionally fall in love with her. He cares for her. So Ahasuerus makes Esther his queen. All is good in the world, right? Well, at the same time, her uncle slash adopted father is out at the city gates one day, and he overhears two of the king's servants plotting to overthrow Ahasuerus. He gets word to people that are trustworthy, and the king is spared. Mordecai has, in essence, saved not only his rule, but has saved his life. As all of that tracks, parallel to that, there is a man, the man who walked out joyful and glad of heart that we read about in chapter 5. Haman is one of the king's most respected and powerful assistants. He's full of himself. He is a man of intense arrogance and selfishness and pride. And he expects when he is walking throughout the kingdom, he expects people to bow when he walks by. And guess what? Everybody bows before Haman except one man. You guessed it, Mordecai. Mordecai refuses. And Scripture tells us that this infuriates Haman, so much so that he sets out. Now, here's one of several conspiracy theories. This is the most hideous one throughout the book and the one that drives the story. Haman not only plots Mordecai's death, but he plots the entire Jewish people living in the empire. He plots their death. He goes to King Ahasuerus and fidgets and manipulates the truth, and he talks Ahasuerus into signing a decree that on a certain day the next year, Jews everywhere throughout the kingdom will be executed. Not just in Susa, but throughout the empire. Now, what Ahasuerus does not know is that he not only is not aware that Mordecai, who has spared his life, is a Jew, but his wife, his queen, that he loves dearly, is a Jew. And there the table is set. The table is set for conspiracy and scheming, because that is what has happened and that's what is going on. Mordecai gets word of Haman's plan and the fact that it's going to happen. It's now the law of the land that on this particular day the Jews will be executed. He goes to the gate of the king's palace in sackcloth and sits in ashes and begins to fast and cry out. Well, it's kind of a public spectacle, and word gets to Esther. She doesn't know what's going on. She knows nothing of this plot. And Mordecai is not allowed in the palace and refuses to leave his stay in sackcloth and ashes. But he does get word to Esther as to what's going on. And he says, you need to go before the king and you need to tell him what's going on and see if he will not change his decision. And Esther realizes that for anyone, including the queen, to go to the door of the throne room and the king to lay eyes on you, that if he does not raise his gold scepter, it's all in here, you are to be executed, even the queen. And so she's reluctant to go, and it's at that point in time where perhaps one of the most famous verses in Esther is spoken by Mordecai. He says, perhaps, Esther, you have been raised up for such a time as this. This is the reason you are queen. This is the reason you have won favor with the king, because of this. So she agrees to do it. So Esther goes in before the king. He raises the scepter and she's allowed to come before him. And he is pleased. Remember, he loves his queen. And he says, Esther, queen, ask anything you want, up to half of my kingdom. And Esther does something brilliant. She says, if it pleases the king, I would request that you would attend a banquet that I will throw in your honor and bring your servant Haman with you. The king agrees to do just that. That night, the king can't sleep. This is just another example of, oh, by the way, another little chip falls. Who could explain it? Why would this happen? But on that particular night, he can't sleep. He asks his servants to bring him the chronicles, the history books. They bring, just so happen to bring him the book that when he opens it, he reads and is reminded of the heroic work of Mordecai to report the possible coup and to spare his life. And he asks, has anything ever been done for Mordecai as a result of his valiant effort? And he's told, no, nothing was ever done for him. Well, he says, we've got to do something for him. And so he wonders, what should we present and give to Mordecai? He thinks, I know, I'll ask Haman what he thinks. So Haman is brought before the king, and the king says to him, Haman, what would you give to someone that has been faithful and loyal and looked out for not only your life but your reign of the king? Well, Haman, being this arrogant, conceited, prideful man, believes that the king's talking about him. So he just lays it on thick. I put him on a horse, give him the royal robes, make a parade for him as he processes throughout the city, give him great wealth. And so the king says, that's what we'll do. And then the other shoe drops. Ahasuerus says, go find Mordecai and bring him to me, because that's who I'm talking about. Well, at that point in time, Haman is absolutely flabbergasted. Now remember, this is chapter 6, just a few verses earlier in the verse 9 of chapter 5 that we started with. He leaves happy, joyful, glad of heart. Now he goes home and tells his wife what's happening. Well, his wife says, ever the schemer, says, here's what you do. You build the gallows and go ahead. You need to have Mordecai hanged before the king can do this. Well, in the meantime, Haman, still oblivious to the fact that Esther has any connection to Mordecai, much less is a Jew, attends the banquet in honor of the king, Esther's banquet. And it is there that the plot, the conspiracy, the scheming is laid on the table. And the king is furious. And Haman is hanged on the very gallows that he had prepared for Mordecai. The Jews are spared and saved. And there's even more, but that's as much as we have time for, and I've gone over time already. I want to kind of bring this to a close by making just a couple of observations, if you'll allow me to. Observation one. Whether you know it, see it, or believe it, God is always working and reigning. Reigning, R-E-I-G-N-I-N-G. God is always aware. He is working. He is ruling in complete providential sovereign power. None of this that happens in Mordecai and Esther's life is a coincidence. It is all pieced together by the loving, gracious, sovereign hand of God. You wouldn't know it. In fact, God is actually never named in the book of Esther, but His presence is all throughout this book. The Lord rules and works over things which you and I have no control over. We can be totally oblivious to what's going on behind the scenes, but you can trust something's going on behind the scenes. All right? He is at work in the light, and He is at work in the midst of the darkness. He is at work. Nothing ever transpires or happens that is not filtered through His hand. And here's kind of the coup de grace on this. The Lord is the one who always has the final say, the final word. God determines what happens in the affairs of men. Men may plan, men may scheme, but God determines the outcome. So, whether we know it, see it, or believe it, God is always working and ruling. The second observation is this, and it's pretty simple. I am to live for Christ, period. You are to live for Christ. Whether there is conspiracy amok, whether it seems like the enemy and the evil one is winning and ruling the day, whatever the circumstance, as followers of Jesus, we are followers of Jesus. We're not followers of a political party or the outcome of an election. We're not followers of any clandestine group. We are followers of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we know that God is utterly and literally in control of all things. Therefore, that frees us up to follow Him. Because we have to remember and understand that there is a schemer. And Scripture says that we are to withstand the schemes of the devil. And the way we do that, you go to Ephesians chapter 6. In fact, I'm just going to very quickly read these couple of verses out of Ephesians 6. Notice that Paul acknowledges that there is a schemer and that there is one that would destroy. But what's his word to the followers of Jesus? Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, i.e., all these conspiracies and all these groups and all these ideas that we give credence to and we fear and we get consumed by, that's not the enemy. We wrestle against the rulers, the authorities, the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. Stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth, put on the breastplate of righteousness, as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. In all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit. This is how we live. We live unto the Lord. Even here, in Paul's most specific comments on spiritual warfare, the focus is on God. And the instruction is live for Him. Speak the gospel. Live righteously. Trust in God's word and pray. And pray. That's how we are to live. We are to live unto Jesus. I heard I read a pastor describing the mindset of people that get consumed with conspiracies, and he very accurately pinpoints the problem. He says that he had just, the worship service, Sunday morning service had just concluded. There had been dynamic, very God-exalting music that just brought the body together as they sang unto the Lord. The word, he said, was preached faithfully and with much enthusiasm. And so after it all concludes, he's greeting people as they came by, and this gentleman that it was a member of his church comes up to him and says, "Here, read this article." They're at it again. And he knew in the moment that it was about a conspiracy theory, because the man often brought this to him. And here's what that pastor observed. He said, sadly, what happens when you get consumed by anything other than Christ is that you get consumed by something other than Christ. It is what the prophet Isaiah wrote about in Isaiah 31. "Woe to those who go down to Egypt for help and rely on horses, who trust in chariots because they are many, and in horsemen because they are very strong, but who do not look to the Holy One of Israel, nor seek the Lord." Listen to me. It very well may be that there is a conspiracy afoot in our nation, in the world, in your life. Your challenge is not to worry about those that would seek you harm or even bring about your downfall. You might be Mordecai. God has you. Your instruction is to focus on the glorious God who has saved you and who loves you and who holds you. That's our obligation. That's who we focus on. That's why we say humbly, let the conspiracy theorists come. Let the conspiracies come. Let the scheming enemy of Satan come. I will face them not in my own power, but my eyes will be cast upon the Lord Jesus Christ, and I will allow Him to handle anything that would come against me. I will be faithful to Him. Okay. A little bit different message. Thank you for bearing with me. I want to pray for you, and I want to pray that for all of us, our heart's desire will not be in worry about what somebody else is going to do to us or to those we care about, but our heart's desire would be centered on our glorious Savior. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. For you. And may we never get caught up in anything that would distract our eyes, distract our hearts from you. But may you find us faithful as we live. In the name of Jesus, amen. Well, the Lord bless you. Thanks for being with us. We're going to close with the song of praise. Pay attention. And we'll look forward to doing this again. Amen.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joys. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Was bought with the precious blood.